Good morning, everyone. Oh, thank you. I'm so glad it was reciprocated. I would like to take time to introduce our keynote speaker this morning, a special guest and personal friend, Dr. Jason Ohler. Dr. Ohler has been pioneering the future of education, technology, and learning for over three decades. After he helped develop one of the earliest master's degrees of educational technology for classroom teachers in the early 80s, he went on to direct it for 17 years, bringing together emerging technologies and creative learning processes focused on learning, learner-centered education. Since that time, he has keynoted and worked both online and in schools, at home, internationally, and has helped students and policymakers develop the new media literacies and perspectives that they need to create the futures that they want. He is a passionate promoter of the art, the next R, as well as the need for students to learn how to use technology wisely and safely as digital citizens with the awareness and the compassion. He has won numerous awards for his work and is the author of many books, articles, and online resources. His current book, Digital Community, Digital Citizen, explores the issues of helping our students and ourselves blend our digital and non-digital lives into one integrated, inspired approach to living. His previous book, Digital Storytelling in the Classroom, reminds us that he's foremost a storyteller, telling tales of the futures that are grounded in the past. He teaches in Fielding Graduate University Media and Psychology PhD program, and he continues to teach in the Masters of EdTech program that he created at the University of Alaska. Many call him a futurist, but he prefers to be called a Nowist, believing that we have the vision, the technology, and the mandate to create the communities of learning we need today. The goal is effective, creative, and wise use of technology to bring together community, technology, and learning in ways that work. And while we are at it, to have fun. Today, Jason is going to speak on the five trends that bend to technological trajectories that will change everything. It is my pleasure and honor to work with personal friend and visionary, Dr. Jason Ohler.
Okay, can you hear me back there? All right, you know, normally I have at least 60 minutes to do this, I have 45. So I'm going to go like a roller coaster without brakes. So I'm going to talk fast, so you'll have to listen fast. But if you want to connect with me afterwards, that's how you do it. It's just my name at LinkedIn, Gmail, and so on. And you can download this presentation off my website at jasonohler.com. As you can see, I own the version of Photoshop with a biceps option. So much easier than actually exercising. Well, who's got time anymore? And you know what? I'm not really worried at 61 about my body going. I'm much more worried about my brain going. Fortunately, we now have a thinking cap. True. It's true. As a matter of fact, there's one that's been tested for mathematics. I call it the math hat. So here's the question. If your kids' math scores could go up by 10%, by wearing a hat like that, and it's ugly, we'll call in the fashionistas, they'll take care of that. But if it could go up by 10% and it costs $50, would you get one for your kid? Park that question in your brain, we'll come back to it, because in the longer presentation, I have 9 questions we ask about technological adoption. And number 3 is, why wouldn't we do it? We are now at the point where we have to disprove the negative. Give me a good reason not to do it, and if I can't come up with a good reason not to do it, then I guess we should do it. In fact, the 5 trends that bend at some point, one of those is going to be neuro and biological enhancement. We are going to have the kinds of things that make that generate these kinds of headlines. Math hat makes students STEM ready. Or more interesting to me, citing the need to pass standardized tests, family sues school district for withholding neurological enhancement. That's coming. and it's not that far away, and it's only 2014. Park that in your brain. It's only 2014. Onto the trends that bend. Here's the backstory to the trends that bend. The elephant in the room is data overload, is information overload. We now get so much information on a daily basis that we have absolutely no idea where to park it, what to do with it, and we don't complain because it's so much fun. We're sort of at a data party. As a matter of fact, every time you open an email, you get a little shot of dopamine. We're sort of on this this sort of pleasure high that sort of goes like this all day long, and we're not dealing with the fact that we are so overwhelmed with information, we can't possibly process a fraction of it. I asked myself recently, how much time would it take for me to process legitimately and responsibly the amount of information I get in an average day? And what do I mean by that? Well, in my email box, I subscribe to 6, 7, 8 listservs. I'm sure you all do. You are part of conversations with people in your field. I get recommendations to watch TED Talks, to read books. You all do. And I sat down and I made sort of a rough calculation. If I were to follow up on those minimally and responsibly, it would take 19 days. And if I wanted to take Saturdays off so I could play with my grandkids, please say, aw, aren't they cute? I want to tell you, there's nothing more recalibrating that's ever happened to me than to become a grandfather. My sense of the future now goes way, way out there. I look at them and I ask myself, in 10 years, what will they be taking to school? What's going to be their BYOD, or what's school going to be? So that's 21 days. And then if I really want to add time to process what I get, to make connections, to sit there and reflect on it and think about it, and I want to count in those days where I don't even look at my email because I am on a mission to go find out something on the web, I'm somewhere between 30 and 40 days. And we are left with this most amazing turn of events in history. Abundance is disruptive. I don't think we've ever had this before. Abundance is now disruptive. We don't know what to do with it. So, on to the trends that bend. I'm going to talk about big data. What happens when you have the technological capacity to find, store, and process all the information you want? We're going to look at augmented reality, known to those in the business more as immersive reality. We're going to take a quick look at semantic webs 3 and 4, the web of data and the web of things. We're going to take a look at xTreme BYOD. And of course, whatever is xTreme today is normal tomorrow. And we're going to take a quick look at transmedia storytelling. Transmedia storytelling is huge outside of education. It is hovering outside of education right now, trying to find some portal of entry. But it's absolutely huge everywhere else. We're going to take a look at the lens through which I look at things. Digital citizenship, and basically digital citizenship asks the question, how does a technology connect me and disconnect me? My eyeglasses connect me to the world. They disconnect me from all the people I used to have to depend upon to get around. My cell phone connects me to people far away, disconnects me from the people sitting next to me. And if you really want to know whether you have an effective digital citizenship program and all you have is a list of do's and don'ts for your students, you do not have an effective digital citizenship program. You can measure its effectiveness based on whether students have the opportunities themselves to explore questions about their digital lifestyles. More about that in the afternoon session. I love what I call you're in charge activities. So I work with middle and high school students, and I say, forget what's on the books. I'm putting you in charge. What are you going to do about big data? What are you going to do about Google Glass? They're going to come into the school. What do you think the policies and guidelines ought to be? fascinating conversations, and you get the feeling it's the first time anyone's ever asked them. And if we don't want them to game the system, they have to help frame the system. Okay, on to big data. Oh yes, I'm sorry, nope. And then we'll take a look at each one of the five in terms of how it bends education. And that brings us to that woman right there who is the protagonist of our story. Now the story is the story of information overload. The arc of the story basically goes like this. Drowning in information, our hero is rescued by the trends that bend and the knowledge gained during the journey and falls cautiously in love with an info-overwhelmed world. And the backstory to all this begins there. Remember that? I remember in school, we would get an assignment in social studies, and then we would race down to the library and pray that the volume we needed from the encyclopedia wasn't checked out, because that was what we had to work with. And fast forward to today, and I did a Google search recently for global warming, which yielded 62 million hits in less than a second. And that gives us what we need in any good story, and that is a dragon to slay. We need inside dragons to slay and outside dragons to slay, something I talk about in my storytelling workshop, which I'm not doing here, unfortunately. But there she is, with many dragons to slay. Those are all the places she really should go every day if she's going to be a responsible digital citizen. And we're going to throw her a life raft through those five trends that bend. And the moral of the story, again, is abundance is disruptive. Now, in the longer presentation and the nine questions we ask, I'm going to skip right to question number one. And it really is this. We can have what we want. We can have whatever we want in a world in which there are millions of programmers who can make apps that blow your mind. We can have whatever we want. Question number one is, so what do we want? We can have any educational system we want right now. We have the technology and the connectivity to do it. So what do we want? And question number six is, when do we talk about this stuff? And I'm afraid the question in an average school day is usually never. Okay, on to big data. So the reason you're looking at a 737 engine is because in December of 2012, there was a flight from Seattle to Anchorage, Alaska Airlines, and everything was going fine until something happened. And the something that happened was that one of the engines stopped working. Just stopped working. A bad thing for a jet engine to do. So it makes an emergency landing in Juneau, Alaska. And I get a little freaked out about this because I travel a lot on Alaska Airlines 737s. I set up a Google alert. Sure enough, in 4 months, three alerts. And I go, wow, okay. Anybody looking into this? Long story short, I'm talking to the FAA a month later. And I said to them, hey guys, what's going on? And he said, well, if it makes you feel any better, before that plane landed in Juneau, we had assembled Boeing, who bought the engine, GE, who made it, Alaska Airlines, who uses it, and the FAA, and we were sitting around a table in Seattle and figured out the problem before the plane had landed. And that was made possible by the fact that that flight generated and streamed 2 terabytes of data. And that's the norm. And you can be amazed by the fact that a plane can stream 2 terabytes of data, but what I'd prefer you be amazed by is the fact that we now have no storage limitations. And it's just getting better or worse depending upon how you look at it. I had the great pleasure of having Marshall McLuhan as a teacher at the University of Toronto. And the medium is the message or the massage, as he preferred to call it in his later years. And what I mean by that is, if we can store all the data we want, we will. That's sort of the way we adapt. The technology sort of points us in a direction and gives us the illusion sometimes of being in charge. If you were to go home after this conference and discover you had an infinitely large attic, think about that. You wouldn't throw away anything. So, how big is big? Well, let's look at one number, 700 billion. It's really pretty small these days. That's the approximate minutes per month that people spend on Facebook, which really seems pretty small when you compare it to the number of molecules and a grain of sand. But probably something that's much more interesting and relevant to us and people like you is the petabyte, which has become sort of the lowest common denominator in terms of units of data. And it's 20 million filing cabinets, big deal. But it is more importantly this. Walmart collects 2.5 petabytes of data every hour on its customers, so it can serve them better. Google collects 24 petabytes of data a day. Facebook, 30 plus a day. And they're very upfront about this. They're very clear about the fact that they're there to read your email. So when you're talking about Hawaii, because you live in Alaska and it's February, you say to yourself, God, I'd love to go to Hawaii. Bing, on the right-hand side, deals to get to Hawaii. Flip-flops, $3 for $5. And we all have this love-hate relationship with this. Get out of my email, except for that one, thank you. So here's what we take away from this. Our output is their input. That is the way it works. And big data is no big deal anymore. We also should take away this. There is no separating yourself out from the big data juggernaut. Everybody wants to be able to find out anything they want about somebody else, but they don't want the world to be able to do that about them. And it doesn't work that way. It is very much a package deal. Now, those people who are in the big data world talk about the four V's. They want data, in terms of data, they want volume, validity, veracity, and velocity. And here's the thing to focus on, velocity. They want their data to have velocity. Now, the standard research paradigm is, if I'm going to study some kind of math program we're using in ninth grade, the parameters of the research project are this class, this semester, this grade, these students, this intervention, over this period of time, you draw a box around it, grab your data, and then you shut off the spigot. It's done. That's how research is conducted. Otherwise, you'll study everything. Well, in the world of big data, they do study everything. And it's a very different research paradigm because it says, don't turn the data off, give me as much as you want, and we will analyze it on the fly. And what comes to the fore is a branch of mathematics that has always been with us, but has never been this important, and it's called predictive analytics. And it's getting more and more and more powerful. So we take everything that you do, and it's not just numbers, it's not just credit card stuff. There are incredibly powerful text analyzers that can go into your Facebook conversations and discern from that and infer from what you're saying all sorts of stuff about you and your personality and potentially your quirks and potentially your buying habits and so on. I have PhD students at Fielding in a wonderful program, media psychology PhD program, and they use these very powerful pieces of software and they yield very, very interesting results. And anyway, into the blender goes literally anything. Your credit card, stuff from Facebook, anything from your digital footprint, and out the other end comes some kind of prediction. Now, in the world of business, it's really simple what we're trying to predict. We want to know, how can we get people to buy more stuff of ours? In education, I think the goal is, how can we expedite and facilitate better, more effective learning on the part of students? It's a very different kind of goal to have. But here's what's important here. Our output is their input. That's true, but their outputs become our choices. So here's what happens. They read us. They put stuff in the right-hand column based upon what we think and say. And before we know it, we're living in what Eli Parser called a filter bubble, or what Nicholas Negroponte called the daily me. I have all of my PhD graduate students do a media inventory. I say, I'm not going to look at this because it's usually too embarrassing to them, but where do you get your information? Who do you talk to? People you talk to, news you watch, so on. Put it in a list. You want to be a researcher? Then you need to discern your bias in that list. I invite every one of you to do that. So you step aside, get very objective, look at your inputs and go, wow, look at the filter I use. It's a really healthy thing to do. So how does that help her? It helps her because if we don't have some kind of analytics to go with this oceans and oceans of data and information, we're absolutely and utterly lost. But she's cautiously falling in love because the goals that drive the way we analyze the data are sometimes, and certainly can be, suspect. So how does it impact education? Here's a great article. There was another one recently, the other day, from ASCD. But here's a really good one I like. The title grabbed me. Big Data Makes Its Mark on Schools for Better or Worse. I like that because it is better and worse. It's very much the medical model. So you have your wristband while you're in the hospital. They can scan it and know that they shouldn't give you penicillin, that you would probably respond to this kind of therapy better than that one. You had an operation last year, all these kinds of things that inform doctors in terms of the kind of decisions they're going to make. Well, it's sort of like that in education, minus the wristband, but they can look and say, he really responded to manipulatives when we were dealing with fractions, whatever the case. But you get to sort of build upon the history that students have established for themselves. Of course, the downside, the worst there, is that it does not leave any room whatsoever for inspiration, for having that teacher that just turns you on and makes you go forward. It's a very sort of data-driven, non-anthropological approach to understanding how people learn. And the parents who complained about this, oh, by the way, here are a couple of bullet points you might be interested in. This project had information on millions of students, their names, their grades, their test scores. There was no need for parent permission because what they signed at the beginning of the year covered this apparently. And the parents came along and said, you know what? I know how data works. Data's like water. Might be in a little puddle there, but sooner or later it makes its way to the ocean. And who's going to be there to make sure that my kids' bad grades in fourth grade don't somehow inform and manipulate and somehow color what happens to him in the future? And if we're not concerned about that, then we've learned nothing about how data works. How about Facebook activity? Are they counting that? Not yet, but they will. And it probably won't be the company that's doing this. It'll be another company. Another company will come along and say, I have a powerful text analyzer, and if you give me your kid's social security number, anything that will bridge that database with that one, we can now begin to add those things together and put together some kind of composite that will tell us, supposedly, who your kid is. And not only that, but who he will be basically forever. And that should give us pause. This is a great you're in charge activity for kids. I put them in charge and I say, big data, you're in control of big data. What kinds of controls should we have on your information? And I get unbelievable ideas. Ask them, put them at a table and ask them that question. Trend number two is immersion. Now, immersion comes about Well, most of us know immersion in terms of augmented reality, which is one expression of immersion, but it comes about because we are massively interconnected, and we have mobile devices that are always on and always on us, as Sherry Turkle likes to say. And that puts us here, in between two worlds. And this is where we're going to live now, certainly in my lifetime, forever and forever, some expression of this. And you are going to say, well, no, it doesn't have to be that way. I'll just turn this off. But here's the thing, you're not going to turn it off. These are on forever. There are very few people in here that don't have one of these on right now. And as you go home and there are some families who actually, they sit down at dinner and they go, you got to turn your cell phone off. And I just think to myself, that would be hard for me. It's almost irresponsible to turn your cell phone off. Now, do you remember when the first cell phones came out, you're sitting with a friend and you're talking, you're having coffee, how's it going, the cell phone rings, and they look at it and you got mad. It's like, what are you doing? You're talking, you're having coffee with me. Why are you turning to your phone? Now, 180 degrees. You're being irresponsible and unfriendly if you don't encourage them to take the call. Happened very, very quickly. And if it feels like we're living in the matrix, it's because we are living in the matrix. If I can look at that wall and see a wall and then look at it through my cell phone or my iPad and see a painting, then I am in the matrix. And I'm going to show you some examples of that. Here's one. My wife and I put together augmented reality art galleries. So here's the deal. There's Kara Heights. She was the Alaska Teacher of the Year in 2012. So she is looking at a piece of artwork. This is all K-12 art. And as she looks at that piece of artwork, down from the cloud comes more to add to the artwork, a video of the artist explaining what it is she's doing. All sorts of stuff. I mean, you know how AR works. You can connect any two things you want. And it's also based on where you are. So by virtue of the fact that your GPS is on and she is standing next to a lighthouse in Alaska, down from the cloud comes information about that lighthouse. And because of big data will know that you're a historian buff and will put at the front stuff about the history of the lighthouse versus if you're a botanist and more about the wildlife and the plants that surround it. And it's not just where you are and what you look at, it's how you blink, it's how you move, it's what you say. Anybody here seen people talking to their Google Glass? I have. It's new. It will become quite normal very quickly. And it's not just what you sense, it's what you sense. Big data will inform that experience and tailor it to you. And what can we sense these days? Well, it's absolutely amazing. Look at that. We'll put this in the plus column. Some man lost his hand, now has a new hand, and not only can manipulate with it, but it's wired into his brain, and he can feel with that hand. Then, I don't know whether this goes in the plus or not, minus column. I'll leave that up to you. Go ahead and look at that and let your imagination take you there. It is exactly what it looks like. So, he has one of these machines and he puts his mouth around it, and someone on the other end of an internet connection has one of these machines, and no doubt they have a very deep and meaningful relationship. And it gives you the sensation of kissing. And if that looks a little bit hokey, imagine version 3.0. No, don't do that. Don't do that. So how does this help her? It helps her because the people in AR and immersive reality say we are the antidote to spam, because we guarantee that when we bring two pieces of information together, they're relevant, that it's a piece of information you would want. it's an incredibly effective filter. So in terms of how it bends education, let's take a look. This is 1 minute long, and this everything you see appear on his Google glasses. I call them eyeglasses, small I, big G, on their eyeglasses. And it's all GPS based. And as you're watching this, think about the idea that students could make walking tours that gave tourists information about historical events or historical buildings, or gave biologists information about an ecosystem. So this starts out with him going to his favorite subway stop, and it's closed, and big data and eyeglasses say, here's what we ought to do about it.
Aw, man, really? Hey there, guy. Hey there, little guy. Sweet. Remind me to buy tickets for Monsieur Gaino tonight. Where's the music section? Oh, yes, this is it. Is Paul here yet? Huh. Hey, dude.
I'm actually working with some students in Alaska to create an app like that for tourists. And how do you get on the walking tour that shows you historical buildings and so on in Sitka, Alaska? Well, you make a small donation to the educational technology program. I think it's a great idea. Okay, let me show you 1 minute from the augmented reality art gallery. So it's noisy, so let me tell you what's going on. So it's me, I've got my iPad, I'm looking at a piece of artwork by a student, and it's an interesting project. Each student had to create two portraits. One portrait was of themselves as they felt other people saw them, and then the second one was how they saw themselves. The first one's up on the wall, the second one floats down from the cloud. With that, let me go ahead and play this. Stand by for 7 seconds of my original music. And so these are two parts of ourselves having a conversation. So let's come on up here and take a look. And what's on the right-hand side came down from the cloud. Let's do that again. So, and that triggers that overlay that you see right there. Let's take a look at this one here. Triggers that overlay that you see right there. So you can do just about anything you want. The idea here, or the goal here, is to blend what's in RL, real life, with what's in VR, virtual reality. And the result is you get a new art form. What's the limit on that stuff? This one I won't play in the interest of time, but it's a teacher who goes to the CERN particle laboratory in Switzerland, and through Google Glass beams back into a high school physics class. It's really great. I'll play it in the second one. Okay, so should we be concerned about it? Of course we should be concerned about this. Are you kidding me? We're going to have that stuff built into contacts here in the not too distant future. So whenever somebody leans forward and you're having a drink and that person looks you in the eye and says, so tell me what you really think of your superintendent. Lie. There was a guy recently who was hauled out of a movie theater wearing eyeglasses because the owner of the movie theater was absolutely convinced, and maybe it was happening, that guy was beaming real time out onto YouTube. absolutely possible. When do our students talk about this or even think about it? Usually never, because we don't give them an opportunity. But boy, when I do, they have great ideas about how to regulate eyeglasses as we bring them into school. And it's only 2014, you guys. It's only 2014. And in my session on digital citizenship, I hope to convince you that dealing with a series of issues one after the other is not the way to go. We need something much more foundational, and I call it character education for the digital age. Okay, the semantic web, trend three. Okay, this is webs three and four, the web of data and the web of things. We need to understand that the web has been rewritten many, many times. And you think, God, who did that? I didn't see the RFP for that. Let's rewrite the web. Well, the deal is that we all just keep upgrading as we get new tools and so on, and it's about to take a huge leap in terms of being rewritten. And before we go any further, I have to show you this. Look at that. Do you know what that is? I have no idea what that is. I found that on a government site. The government, federal government, has made available to you millions of pictures and video clips because you paid for them. Some of them are fascinating. I look at that and I say, I have to share that. Perhaps that is the beginning of the Internet of Things. In any event, here's how it works. We started with Web 1.0. I was around when the web just started, and I searched for the word education, and up came seven hits. That's how old I am. And it started like this. We could not write to the web. Only the geeks could write to the web. And then very quickly, it sort of shifted to that, and that's the world of Blogger. And regardless of what the back end really is, we all had at least the ability to add, to read and write to the web. Web 2.1 came along. That added all the multimedia. That brings us up to Web 3.0 and the web of data. And here's the thing. I mean, I'm an English major, so I'm not going to try and dazzle you with my technical understanding of this, but here is the key concept here. In Web 2.0, I can connect my web page to your web page. In Web 3.0, I can connect a very specific piece of data to a very specific piece of data on your web through a relationship. And the result is the web takes a huge leap forward in terms of what appears to be, but isn't really, intelligence. Let me give you an example. Here is a typical search for Michael Jackson. This is a Web 2 search for Michael Jackson. We have over 600,000 hits in less than a second. You know what it's like? And then you go, you read the first three or four and go, oh yeah, okay, I got it. How can you say that? You get out your shovel and you start digging, right? You just sort of slogging through all that stuff. Here's a Web 3 search for the same thing. It looks like a Wikipedia article. The links are gone. Assumptions are built into it. And the basically, the semantic web of data is built upon a lot of assumptions that it thinks you want, and those assumptions are built upon the suggestions that you've made by virtue of what you've looked for. Okay, that's Web 3. Web 4 is the Internet of Things. So literally, I mean everything. This is connected to this, which is connected to this. And you might say, well, what's this pen? What does this pen have to say to my glasses? They'll figure out something. And the idea here is that through advancements in material science, we're going to have connectivity built into everything. And everything's going to have some kind of web address, including people. This is 1 minute long.
We're here today to announce the first synthetic cell, a cell made by starting with the digital code in the computer, building the chromosome from four bottles of chemicals, assembling that chromosome in yeast, transplanting it into a recipient bacterial cell, and transforming that cell into a new bacterial species. So this is the first self-replicating species that we've had on the planet whose parent is a computer. It also is the first species to have its own website encoded in its genetic code.
Oh, no big deal, just making people. We will see a headline someday that reads something like, "Children sues parents for not making him better looking and more athletic." Creepy, huh? I'm afraid it's all too possible. In any event, that's Web 4. So everything is connected. And the bottom line here is that you need to begin to look at everything as an app holder, including that camera right there outside where I spoke at ISTE last year. Everything is an app holder. It's not just a sensor. It has programs built into it that can do certain things. So that camera that watches me as I go down the street to determine whether I'm going too fast is just being recognized as an app holder that can determine whether I signaled as I changed lanes, whether I was driving erratically or not. Everything is an app holder. And I shouldn't really squeeze artificial intelligence into this right here. It doesn't really fit, but I had to put it someplace, especially in light of that headline right there. I offered a MOOC last year on digital citizenship. It's still up. The course is there. You're free to use it. Just email me. I'll tell you where it is, or you can just search for it. But the reality is that we're going to have profound intelligence. Right now, we can already look at student essays, and there's all sorts of software that can tell how good their grammar is and so on. But we can't yet grade for ideas. And that's the next big step. Okay, so how does this help that lady right there? Because the semantic web is going to make this overabundance of information far more connected and intelligent. And again, I want to stress it's not really intelligence, but it's going to bring a much more profound sense of connectivity and make our jobs as people who are trying to swim through these oceans of data a much easier job for us. The impacts of on education basically boil down to who controls the connections. Who controls the connections? If I'm going to connect this piece of data to that piece of data and establish a relationship between those, that relationship could be politically charged. Who controls that layer that's just down from the surface? And what should we care? Should we care about that? And should we change our students' relationship with going out and using information that we find on the web because of it? Holly, I'm turning to you. Can you give me a time check? We're good? Okay, you just do this, okay? Okay, xTreme, BYOD is trend number 4. And let's pause for a piece of student artwork. I love that. Kyler Jukes, Ian Jukes' kid, did that when he was 12. Anyway, okay, on with the show. BYOD was driven by money because people like me went out to school districts and said, "You got to get computers in the 90s. And they said, "We do? Absolutely. 10-year bond for those big computers with the big fuzzy screens and the keyboards that sounded like jackhammers, but it's all that was available at the time. And then they were useless in 4 years, and I made no friends with that. Especially when I said, "Okay, get as many as you want, but you don't need these anymore, you need laptops." Another bond issue. 5 years later, "Sorry, not those laptops, these laptops." 5 years later, "Sorry, not these laptops, these iPads." And you know what? They just finally said, "I give up. I give up." And so the whole idea was that you bring your stuff to school and we're getting out of that business. But the reality is that what people, that the real thing or raison d'etre that moves and pushes BYOD is that everybody wants to go to work with their own individualized workspace. And in the one-to-one world, most of what I see is the standard build, right? every computer as the standard build. No one wants the standard build. If I were to ask every one of you to lay out your computers and we go around and look at them, they would be very different. You found really cool software I've never heard of. You've set up your computer this way. They're just emulating us. We go to work with our phones. I'm 61, so I get to be amazed by this. If you're under 40, you're not going to be amazed by this. But you didn't bring your phone to work. What a weird idea that is. You went to work and this thing rang and you picked it up. I mean, but you bring your phone to work, you bring your computer to work, and they just want to be like us. IT, of course, will have to adjust to that. It's a huge adjustment. But what is their role in a world in which we have wearable technology? We have shirts now where I have a $20 option to become a hotspot so I can go online. We have hoodies now that connect directly to Facebook. We have emotion vests where you plug them in and to a book you're reading and feel what the characters feel. And then we've got, of course, the kissing thing. We're back to the math hat. You gonna buy one for your kid? You definitely are if everybody else has one. How about this? I'll give them to you for free. I'll give them to you. They'll be really, really cool. There's only one catch. And that catch is that as they use them, it streams to Google and to Nielsen. And they don't identify who the person is. They're just looking for trends. Gonna do it? Why wouldn't we do it? Why wouldn't we do it? So how does xTreme BYOD help her who's overwhelmed with data? It helps her because it gives her a highly personalized, individual way to wade into the ocean of information. She gets to do it on her own terms. And how does that change education? Well, xTreme BYOD brings this question, it's probably one of the most important questions we have to face with our kids and technology, right to the fore. Two lives or one? Do we want our students to live two lives or one? Because the reality is, a lot of schools I go to, it's turn the stuff off when they go into school, turn it back on during lunch, or when teachers aren't looking at them, or right after they leave school. And I'm going to suggest that we will be judged by our ability as educators in the future to have helped our students take their digital and non-digital lives and put them together and knitted them together in one inspired, safe, responsible approach to being a human being. But we're not doing that yet. And while we're at it, let's brand BYOD on off. Okay, kids. Turn on your stuff because we're doing this cool project. Now turn them off because we're going to do something that's really weird to you. We're going to talk to each other without a machine between us. You're in charge. I love bringing this one to kids. You're in charge. What are we going to do about the whole BYOD thing? Can anybody bring what they want? Are we going to have blackout sessions where we actually force each other to talk during lunch? What do you want to do? Transmedia, trend number 5, and I will go through this as quickly as I can. It's about storytelling, and this is huge everywhere except in education. There is not a company out there worth its salt that does not have what they would call a transmedia storytelling approach and strategy. And it works, and at the heart of it is a good story, and I wish I had time to talk about the two competing information container approaches. One is the list, doesn't work. A story has problems and resolutions and transformations. I just don't have time to talk about that. But a lot of people look at heroes. Scholars look at this TV show Heroes. How many people have seen that? How many people watch it regularly but don't want to admit it in public? The rest of you. And Tim Kring said it occurred to him that he needed to use what he called the whole buffalo. And the whole buffalo to him was every channel that he could possibly get his hands on was going to become part of that TV show. He was going to maintain the central story, what he called the story canon, but he was going to use Facebook and games. And with Heroes, you could go to a store, you could buy a sword, turn it over, there's a paragraph that advances the narrative. They had comic books that went along with every single week of the show. They had ways for fans. Fan access is huge in transmedia. How do people interact with your story in ways that at least make them feel involved? And if you're interested in this, Henry Jenkins is very definitely the guru on this. He is the guy who came up with the term, the phrase, if it doesn't spread, it's dead. And I want you to picture me with a butter knife the size of a ski. And I'm going like this, and I'm scooping up some zeros and ones from Twitter and a couple more from YouTube, excuse me, and I'm just sort of spreading them into a digital story. And we're going to pick some more up from this place and that place and so on. And the idea is that everything is spreadable, everything is mixable, and the question is, how do we get schools to use multiple channels? And how do we get students to become fans of mathematics? And that question is very firmly on the table right now. So, in terms of Ed Benz, it's like this. When I went to school, my teacher said, your homework is, I assumed it would look like that. That was the foundational literacy. That's the new foundational literacy. And there are so many literacies that are involved with it. The question on the table that we have not dealt with is, what is our role as a school to help students become great makers of media? We have them read great writers and say, write like that. We have them study great mathematicians and say, do math like them. We do not have them watch great digital stories or documentaries and say, make media like them. Why not? It's hovering. We just don't quite know what to do with it. And the thing is that the media collage, it will absorb everything that developers throw at us. It has to. Literacy has always meant consuming and producing the media forms of the day, whatever they are. It has always meant you have to write well what you read. If you can only read, can't write, then you're half literate. And that means that art has become the fourth R. And I'm not talking about the arts in education, I'm talking about art in education. I'm talking about the fact that the Common Core really blew it when they didn't have the art teachers at the table. Not because of the arts, but because the ability to write, to create, and to communicate with something beyond words is very clearly an extension of our literacy and should have been considered. Tsk, tsk, big omission. We need creatical thinking. We're going to take creative thinking, we're going to take critical thinking, and we're going to put them together. This idea that they don't exist together is absolutely nuts. And so transmedia is multimedia, multi-channeled, social and personal, accommodates emerging media, has a central story, and access for a fan base. So here's where we are. We're at the end here. Here's where we are. She is finally happy in a goofy way. Because even though she's swimming in data, it's being understood and parsed and synthesized by big data. It has a foundation that gives it a lot more sense and connectivity in terms of the semantic web. She gets to wade into that ocean, however it is she wants to do that, and she gets to tell her own story, which is the best way to personalize anything. Stories help us make sense of what otherwise is the chaos of life, and education will never be the same. The new normal is simply this. The attitude has become the aptitude. Things are changing so quickly that your desire to learn new stuff determines how smart you are. We need creatical thinking, which I mentioned. We need process that permeates everything. We need new literacies, and we need to see it all through digital citizenship. And let me end with this. We're gonna have digital makeup, you guys. Digital makeup. I don't like video conferencing. I like audio conferencing. You know what I do on audio conferences? I put the mute on, I lift weights. Every couple minutes, I take the mute off and I say, sounds sort of expensive to me. Thank you, Dr. Ohler. You're very welcome. We're gonna have video conferencing, and because of that, we're gonna have digital makeup. You're going to be able to sit it on a video conference, look at yourself and go, oh God, I didn't shave. Bing, you shaved. Don't like your jewelry or makeup? Bing, everybody else sees what it is. You tell them to see, feigned attention. You're like this, everyone's gonna see. You're gonna be able to program your computer so that when your boss tells a joke, automatically, she will hear you go, ah. How does it work? Well, here's how it works. That's me after my 40th high school reunion. I was out all night. There was no putting lipstick on this pig. I had a beta piece of software. Not bad. That's what they saw in the video conference. And I actually looked like that in RL. Not bad. And of course, if cost is no object. When do we talk about this stuff, you guys? I don't know, but I sure hope it's soon. Whatever you do, please go tell your story. I'll see you at ISTE. Thank you.